There are many proposed solutions to the Fermi Paradox, aka, where are all the aliens? In 2021, a new one was published that has gained a lot of attention, the so-called Grabby Aliens hypothesis. Today, I'm going to explain what this theory proposes and ultimately why I don't buy it. Interestingly, Grabby Aliens is the brainchild of an economist, not an astronomer. That's Robin Hanson. The basic idea is that the development of intelligent life is very rare in the cosmos, but in some small fraction of cases, the aliens become grabby. Okay, so what is grabby? It's simply a species that inexorably expands through space and changes stuff in a fairly obvious way. Hanson leans on his economics background here and argues that transforming the environment is a defining quality of human civilization, and thus by extension, aliens too. Grabby aliens are, by definition, loud and obvious, and if they were out there, we'd see entire regions of the sky that were in some way noticeably different from the rest of the universe. A key feature of the model is that the emergence of intelligent life is very rare, and in fact, humanity can be understood to be the product of a series of improbable evolutionary transitions known as the hard steps model. This hard steps hypothesis is a whole other beast, popularized by the cosmologist Brandon Carter. In a seminal paper from 2007, Carter imagined a series of doors with hard locks that someone is forced to pick in a fixed interval of time. Now, if the average time to pick each lock is longer than the available window, a so-called hard lock, then it's very unlikely they'll get through even the first door, let alone a series of them. But like monkeys on a typewriter, given enough instantiations, someone will get lucky and pick through all of the doors in the allotted time. It turns out that even if these locks have wildly different difficulty levels, the people who do luckily break through the series of them will look back and find that it took them about the same amount of time to break through each of those doors. So now Carter applies this idea to biological evolution. He argues that there were a series of transitions that were necessary to get to us, but they would all appear roughly uniformly spaced in time if they were all hard steps. Yet more, the time left on the clock would roughly equal the total available time divided by the number of hard steps. So given that the Earth has a total habitable window of 5.4 billion years, but only has about 0.9 billion years left, this yields 6 hard steps, give or take a few. So to come back to Grabby Aliens, the fact that these transitions are hard means that barely anyone should be around the universe after just 14 billion years, the present age of the cosmos. The current population is thus just the lucky few lockpickers that happen to break through, which includes us. But here's the thing, some other Earths out there, but not us, could last for trillions of years, and for them, success is not a matter of if, but when using this model. Even if the steps take 100 billion years each, they have the patience to wait it out. The idea of planets lasting this long is not so crazy. After all, the most common type of star in the universe is an M-Dwarf, and those indeed last for trillions of years. So this creates a dilemma. Most sentient, conscious beings should be born hundreds of billions, if not trillions of years from now. The fact that we live so early in the history of the cosmos presents somewhat of a mystery. Hanson argues that the solution to this problem is to put a deadline on the available window for civilizations to emerge. New civilizations simply cannot emerge a trillion years from now because something about the universe fundamentally prohibits that. And to Hanson, that something is grabby aliens. These species expand out and gobble up all of the habitable real estate, leading to a permanent phase change that prevents species like us from ever emerging again. So that's the basics of the model, but when trying to estimate the various parameters of it, such as the expansion speed and emergence rate, Hanson and colleagues have to contend with a fairly obvious piece of evidence that flies in the face of this theory. We don't see any grabby aliens out there. And remember, by definition, grabby aliens are obvious and easily detectable. To get around this, they invoke the clever trick of setting the speed of expansion to be very fast, in fact, approaching the speed of light. Since we can only receive information from distant parts of the cosmos at the speed of light, then we have no way of detecting such grabby aliens until they were basically here. The final model ends up predicting that some 40 to 50% of the universe is currently occupied by grabby aliens and that this expansion wave is growing, filling in the remaining holes as it goes. We'll encounter this wave of colonization in about a billion years' time, and Hanson predicts a 1 in 10,000 chance that we will ourselves become such a grabby civilization before that time. So that's the idea, and it has caught on. PBS Spacetime, Kurzgesagt, and many others have made videos describing this idea, which have amassed tens of millions of views. Hanson himself has discussed the idea on Lex Fridman's podcast, and I think you would be forgiven at this point for assuming that the idea has become widely accepted and almost canonical at this point. You know, I don't usually make videos weighing in on other people's theories, but many of you have asked for my opinion on this, and I haven't seen any pushback out there, so I am going to offer a counterweight. But before I do, let me first just say that I think this idea is very clever, thought-provoking, and I hold Hanson's work in high regard. Out of respect, I sent my criticisms to Hanson ahead of making this video, and we even chatted about it together cordially. What I hope my criticism does here is provide an opposing position, so you can ultimately make up your own mind about this provocative idea. With that in mind, let's get into my criticisms. Before I do, I just want to take a moment to thank the sponsor of today's video, and that is Storyblocks. One of the most challenging parts of making these kinds of videos is the editing. We are often searching for that perfect B-roll clip to explain a concept, and this is where Storyblocks saves the day. They offer a huge library of high-quality videos, sound effects, music, images, and video templates supporting things like After Effects, Premiere Pro, and DaVinci. That is over 1.5 million digital assets at your fingertips. Thanks to Storyblocks, it has never been easier to create stunning, high-quality videos. For a single monthly subscription, you can get licensed and unlimited access to their huge library. To get started, head to storyblocks.com/coolworlds. Once again, that is storyblocks.com/coolworlds. Clicking that link helps us out too, so please do check them out. Now, back to the video. Okay, when it comes to grabby aliens, I have three major criticisms, so let's walk through these together. Criticism number one, the hard steps model. Grabby aliens is predicated upon the hard steps model, which we don't know to be true. It may very well be that the development of intelligent life is in fact very easy. It just takes a few billion years to play out. A remarkable feature of evolution is the continual growth in biological complexity, a property that assembly theory argues could even be used to detect life elsewhere. At the end of the day, if intelligence bestows evolutionary advantages, then perhaps it is inevitable given a few billion years. A few years back, I took the chronology of evolution and life on Earth, including our own emergent state, and published a Bayesian analysis of this question. The result was inconclusive. Everything we know about our own history is consistent with either a hard or easy step model. You can check out our earlier video for a deep dive all about this. Okay, so is there any other evidence for hard steps? Well, one might be tempted, as indeed Carter was, to take his 6 inferred steps, look back at the evolutionary record, and try to identify what those transitions might be. A possible sextet would be abiogenesis, bacteria, eukaryotes, sexual reproduction, animals, and then civilization. But here's the thing, that is just painting in the numbers after assuming that the hard steps model is true. An evolutionary biologist could come along and argue about whether each of these were truly hard or easy, or perhaps there might be some other missing hard steps, like photosynthesis, for example. This whole exercise is just way too subjective, and to me, it doesn't serve as actual evidence for the hard steps model. In the original paper, Carter argued that the ace in the hole for hard steps was that it explained an apparent coincidence. Why is it that the main sequence lifetime of the Sun is comparable to the timescale it took intelligent life to develop. He argued that there's no mechanistic reason why these two should be connected, but Hard Steps explains this apparent coincidence since most lucky lockpickers will break through the last door near the end of the allowed time window. Now, I'm no evolutionary biologist, although neither is Carter, but I'm just not so sure that this really is a coincidence. Let me just offer one possible reason as to why. The Earth's environment is obviously totally dominated by the Sun, and over the last 4 billion years, the Sun's luminosity has increased by 25 to 30%, and that will obviously impact the Earth. The early Earth likely had a CO2-rich atmosphere, but as the Sun increased in luminosity, it increased the rate of precipitation and weathering on the Earth, which in turn caused it to pull CO2 out of the air and fundamentally alter the chemical composition of the atmosphere. So the Earth's environment is changing on a timescale that is linked to the Sun's main sequence lifetime, and those changing conditions would surely precipitate evolutionary adaptations for Earth's inhabitants. So I don't really accept Carter's coincidence, and without that, the Hard Steps model lacks any data-driven explanatory power. To be clear, I am not claiming that the Hard Steps model is definitively wrong, merely that it is unproven, and therefore it serves as a shaky foundation for the Grabby Aliens hypothesis to sit upon. Hanson's model not only assumes Hard Steps, but also that the number of Hard Steps is a universal value on every planet and moon out there. Given the potential, enormous range of diverse environments which life could thrive, I'm not sure I'm comfortable with this assumption either. In the end, there could actually be another step that the Hard Steps model actually ignores. That is the probability of transitioning from a human-like civilization to a Grabby Aliens one. Perhaps that probability is just incredibly small, and that explains why we don't see them out there in the sky. So let's move on to my criticism number two, which concerns the treatment of M-Dwarfs. Even if Hard Steps holds, this for me is the most concerning issue of the paper. Look, the Hard Steps model predicts that for sun-like stars, the emergence of intelligent civilization should be a very rare event. That's because the stars have short lifetimes, less than 10 billion years, but each lock might take typically much longer than that in order to be picked. Yet more, the sun-like stars are on the way out. The universe is just not manufacturing them the same kind of numbers that it used to. This fact is also true for smaller M-dwarf stars as well, but crucially, those stars should live for trillions of years. So, even if the locks are hard to pick, they have the patience to wait it out and eventually succeed. So this poses a problem. In the story of our universe, most civilizations should be born at far, far later times than today around these diminutive M-dwarf stars. Grabby Aliens makes the universe itself less habitable over time and thus solves this problem. We were not born a trillion years from now because there's hardly any Earth-like planets left at that point. My whole problem with this solution is that there is a much easier one available to us. That is that M-dwarfs are not habitable to begin with. If M-dwarfs cannot, for whatever reason, produce intelligent beings like ourselves, then it is no surprise that we don't live in the M-dwarf-dominated future. There's two reasons why I think that this works better than the Grabby Aliens hypothesis. First, we already are accumulating plenty of evidence that suggests that M-dwarfs really are a danger to their planets. They exhibit intense flaring and magnetic activity for the first billion years of life that can strip parts of their atmosphere entirely. Recent JWST data of the TRAPPIST-1 system has established that the two innermost planets have indeed long lost any thick atmosphere. Super-Earths, with their higher surface gravity, might be able to resist this process, but they pose other challenges. Many are hypothesized to be ocean worlds for which technology might simply never develop in an aquatic environment, for example, how you can do combustion. Further, their higher surface gravities has been shown to make them prisons for chemical rocket systems, and such inhabitants may simply never have a space age. So we have legitimate astrophysical concerns, but a second reason why I would throw out the M-dwarfs is that by doing so, it kills two birds with one stone. Grabby Aliens tries to solve the mystery as to why we don't live a trillion years from now when M-dwarfs dominate. If instead we remove the M-dwarfs out of play, then that obviously solves the same problem, but it also solves an additional problem as to why we don't live around an M-dwarf now in today's current epoch. I've dubbed this the Red Sky Paradox in a previous paper and video, which highlights that M-dwarfs greatly outnumber sun-like stars, and thus the fact we don't live around one now is already kind of weird. Grabby Aliens has no way of solving that problem. I think it's actually really interesting that Robin Hanson and myself got interested in the same problem, humanity's apparent early emergence in the history of the universe, in the same year, 2021. But we arrived at totally different solutions. I'll let you decide which one is more plausible. Last but not least, my third criticism, which is best described as philosophical issues. As noted earlier, Hanson's hypothesis has a pretty obvious major issue. Grabby aliens are, by definition, easily detectable, and yet we don't see them. This point would ordinarily falsify the theory. It disagrees with observation. But to get around this, the theory invokes what, to me, is a kind of get-out-of-jail-free card. It states the grabby aliens are all expanding at speeds close to the speed of light. This conveniently solves the problem because, of course, we cannot detect something traveling at the speed of light until it arrives here. A classic example is that if the sun disappeared, we wouldn't know about it for 8 minutes because it takes light that long to travel the distance from the sun to the Earth. For me, this jeopardizes grabby aliens as what we might call a credible scientific theory, for it means that there is no experiment we can design that can falsify this hypothesis, even in principle. The philosopher Karl Popper used the criterion of falsifiability to delineate science from metaphysics. If a theory cannot be falsified, it cannot be considered within the remit of science. The other philosophical complaint I have about grabby aliens is a complaint which I've actually had about many other alien topics as well. Look, Hanson points out a really interesting puzzle, the same one I highlighted in my Red Sky Paradox paper. Why do we live in the early history of the universe? Obviously, I think that is an interesting and poignant question, since, of course, I've published it already myself. My problem is that Hanson invokes aliens as the solution, and to me, aliens should be the solution of last resort, not first resort. This is just my personal preference, so feel free to disagree here, but time after time, history has taught us to be careful about invoking aliens to explain things that we don't yet understand. What's that weird interstellar asteroid? Aliens. What's that weird pulsating star? Aliens. What's that weird streak on Mars? Aliens. And yet, every time, we were wrong. We have a bad habit of invoking aliens to explain things because it's so damn easy. They can explain everything and anything you want. You know, it's remarkably similar to how the ancients invoked gods and deities to explain why the sun rises, why the rain falls, and why the planets move. I think we can do better. So, those are the three major reasons why I don't buy this theory. I think a far simpler hypothesis is twofold. First, M-dwarfs don't permit creatures like us to develop on them, solving the Red Sky Paradox and our apparently early emergence in cosmic history. Second, the emergence of aggressive expanding civilizations just doesn't happen for some reason. No need to invoke speed of light colonization waves. Despite my criticisms, I have enormous respect for Robin Hanson's work, and I think this idea is thought-provoking and it intellectually advances our discussions of potential alien behaviors. It is an important theory that deserves attention. And I hope that this discussion provides some counterweight and ultimately shows how we can cordially and respectfully disagree with one another. As always, I'd love to hear your thoughts down below in the comments. I really do appreciate seeing your viewpoints down in there. And if you want to hear my opinion about Dark Forest or other alien theories, please do also let me know down below in the comments. So until next time, everyone, stay thoughtful and stay curious. Hey, thank you so much for watching this video, everybody. I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to hit the like and subscribe buttons. If you want to become a supporter to my research team, the Cool Words Lab, you can use the link up above, down below. I sincerely appreciate it. And if you haven't already seen it, we have a podcast. Just go to Cool Words Podcast on YouTube. Again, links down below, and check that out too. Thanks again for watching.